عشرة في المكان المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. My presentation for today goes by the theme of the effects of the South African apartheid system on the black South African family structure. This presentation focuses on two aspects around the theme. The first aspect is a brief background of the South African apartheid model. The second aspect focuses on four specific South African apartheid laws and how they affected the black South African family structure. The bias focus on the black South African family structure is due to the fact that although South African apartheid laws were implemented across racial lines, they were primarily structured and socially engineered against the black South African masses and had more devastating effects on them than on any other race. However, this paper does not dismiss the fact that the coloreds and South African Indian peoples also experienced some form and level of oppression at the hands of the apartheid regime. Moreover, this paper does not focus on how the South African apartheid laws harm the white minority, because it holds an unexpressed opinion that South African apartheid laws benefited all kinds of white people in South Africa, the majority being the Afrikaner, English and Jews, including those Jews and other South African whites who opposed the South African apartheid system through the SACP and other anti-apartheid movements and political parties from the 50s until the end of the South African apartheid regime. Brief background of the South African apartheid system. It is important to note that there are different forms of apartheid systems that existed in different times from the 19th to the 21st century in different parts of the world. There was an American apartheid system that existed during and after slavery from the 1700s to the 1960s. The Australian and New Zealand apartheid system that existed around the 1890s and 90% extermination of the aboriginals in Australia and New Zealand was successfully carried out. The Canadian apartheid system that existed around the 1870s to date through the Indian Act law. Last but not least, the Israeli apartheid system that existed from the 1940s to date. As for the foundation of the South African apartheid system, Henry Canning argues in his book, Verwoed, the Architect of Apartheid, that the modern day South African apartheid ideology was founded by Henry French Verwoed around the 1920s, and it was systematically implemented from 1947 to the 1970s, and it lasted until the mid-90s. Besides the fact that Verwoed was a psychologist, come political strategist, come senate and prime minister, he had a degree and BA honors in Christian studies, master's and doctorate in philosophy and psychology, and did his post-doctorate on applied psychology in Germany and America. This biographical summary says a lot about the brains behind the South African apartheid system. In fact, Verwoed is considered to be the most educated president South Africa ever had so far. His cabinet consisted of apartheid hardliners and Afrikaner intellectuals, of which I call the creme de la creme of the apartheid regime, which explains why we're in the mess we find ourselves in. The South African apartheid system consisted of three key components. The law, number one, the law, the Afrikaner masses and the Dutch Reformed Church in particular, and the apartheid regime's international relations, which included Israeli and American ties. The number of apartheid laws passed during the year 1949 and 1970 are estimated to be 28 in total. All these laws had a systematic, direct and indirect effect on the black South African family structure. These effects were very important to the South African apartheid regime. This is because with the dismantled family, there is no solid community. Without the solid community, there is no strong mass resistance. And without the strong mass resistance, there is a reasonable guarantee of the sustainability of the South African apartheid hegemony. The fear of the Afrikaner hegemonic instability and loss of power at the hands of the Bantu majority, as described by Verwoed, is quite evident in many speeches he gave as Prime Minister in newspaper article interviews. The four apartheid laws are as follows. The Bantu Investment Cooperation Act No. 34 of 1959. This act allowed white people to invest through business in black township and generate income. One of these notorious apartheid government business investments were the government-owned shebeens or taverns in the townships. Alexandra is considered to have a tavern on every single street. In Soweto, the apartheid regime strategically put a tavern in every train station. The purpose of doing such is understood to be so that black people and black males in particular, as the main working gender among the blacks, can drown their sorrows of poverty and oppression every Friday after payday upon returning from work. This strategy perpetuated abusive and negligent male family figures who also turned out to be womanizers as a short-term outcome and contributed towards crime and made absent parents through imprisonment and early death as long-term outcome. The Bantu Education Act No. 47 of 1953. This act played a significant role in creating a special form of education for the black people which was different from the education of other nations. Its purpose was to prevent black people from developing intellectually and progressing in life by providing them with such education which will make it easier for the regime to rule them. In this way, it played a role in reinforcing stereotypes related to infighting and disunity among black South Africans, which led to black-on-black violence. Infighting, disunity, and violence in a community translated into an unhealthy environment which made it difficult for black society to produce a family structure with untainted values and principles. The extension of University Education Act No. 45 of 1959. This act allowed the regime to put an end for apartheid students to attend white universities such as the University of Cape Town and Wits at large, and limited the number of black students which could attend other universities in particular. With the shaky family structures which had a little understanding of the importance of higher education, poor Bantu education, lack of resources for higher education, and limitation of number of black students in tertiary, it meant that a lot of young black boys and girls were stuck in townships after completing school. This laid a perfect ground for teenage pregnancy and crime culture or gangsterism in the townships, which in turn added more weight on weakening the already weak black family structures. The South African apartheid regime formulated the above two laws, thereafter called black people barbarians and ignorant baboons, justifying their oppression, saying that black people do not qualify to self-govern, and therefore they are in need of a white man to paternalistically show them how to live like civilized beings, as if black people were the ones who were responsible for their underdevelopment in the first place, and not the apartheid regime. This is the same rant which has been thrown at the ANC and Zuma in particular today. The Group Areas Act No. 41 of 1950. Oscar Barbarin and Linda Richard provide us with a picture of how the Group Areas Act has wrecked family structures in their book, Mandela's Children Growing Up in Post-Apartheid South Africa, on page 32, and I quote, "Black people were left without property, largely uneducated and unemployed. Moreover, their family structures were torn apart by influx control, migrant labor, forced removals, and restrictive housing policies," end quote. Through influx control, only a certain number of a family are allowed by law to relocate from one area to the other, leaving the rest behind. Through migrant law, people such as mine workers and domestic workers will leave their families for an extended period of time, leaving their household with one or no parental figureheads. The Food and Agricultural Organization provides a detailed description of how migrant labor had a long-term effect on a family structure in their book, Apartheid, Poverty, and Malnutrition, from page 37 and 47. I would like to close with a quote from Barbarin and Richard, which says, and I quote, "It is difficult to acknowledge the pain with which these experiences have afflicted the country, insinuating themselves into every aspect of South African lives. The effects of institutionalized racism have been devastating for blacks, both materially and psychologically." With that, I say thank you.